Ali, we need to unwrap. We'll see. For now, I have them in the shot.
The camera's rolling.
Okay.
Quiet and set. 5.
Okay.
4, 3, 2, 1, action.
Hi everyone, and welcome back to the Safe Space with Tubby M. I am honored to have my personal therapist and pastor, and her name is Nandi Flemming. Welcome to the show, Nandi Flemming. How are you today?
I'm well, thank you, Tubby. Thank you for having me. It's a privilege.
You're welcome. So now today, we are delving into the topic of trauma specifically and other things. For now, we'll start with trauma. So please tell myself and the viewers that are currently watching this episode, what is trauma?
I think the most important part of trauma is that it's a deeply disturbing or distressing event that somebody experienced. And I think a lot of times when people think of trauma, they think of it must be something terrible. But trauma is very unique, as in the sense of that each individual will experience trauma in their own way. So something that's maybe distressing and traumatic for me might not be distressing or traumatic for you. And so sometimes we think it has to be a massive car crash, or it has to be that I went through a personal rape or some terrible story. But I've heard people who have gone through an experience of I stepped on a spider, and it so traumatized them. And to us, it might sound exactly silly. Kind of like, sorry, you're traumatized by stepping on a spider. But for some reason, in their internal bodies and in their minds, their body experiences the traumatic. This is why it's something that's personally disturbing or distressing to you. And so it's very unique to each individual.
Yeah. And the second one I want to ask in relation to trauma is, well, I think you answered me, but I'll ask it in any case. I've made notes. How does it affect you as a person, your traumatic experience?
So trauma affects people in various ways. I think the most important thing to realize is that it affects us in the 5 different areas. So it affects you cognitively. Mm. It affects your thoughts. It affects you emotionally. So you're going to feel certain emotional disturbances. If you've been traumatized, you're going to have maybe lack of concentration. Maybe you're going to have disturbing dreams, disturbing thought processes. You might feel very confused. So that's cognitively, physically, emotionally, physically, it also affects your body. Some people might feel, you know, like a heaviness in their chest. They might actually feel that they're sick, but they're not actually physically ill. It's the trauma that's affecting their body.
Psychosomatic.
Making them feel sick. You might get back pains, headaches, things like that. It affects you spiritually. Mm. You know, when you go through a traumatic incident, you might ask the question of God, why did you allow this? You know, other people become more spiritual when they go through traumatic events, praying more, going to church more, finding that meaning. And then behaviorally, you know, trauma makes us behave in specific ways. Yeah. And so in all 5 of those areas, it affects us, and it varies from person to person. There's no blueprint that I can say the way it's going to affect Tabi is the way that it's going to affect me.
Okay, cool. And then, so my personal thing, obviously I've done this with Nandi as well, is to explain to the viewers, right? What is debriefing? What is debriefing? And can you please walk us through the process of debriefing? Because now we have spoken about what trauma is. We know what trauma is. We know how it affects you cognitively, emotionally, physically, behavior, and also spiritually. We have that checked. But now that we have our traumatic experience, we know how it affects me as a person. Now I need to know, fine, what's the next step? What exactly is debriefing? And can you walk me through the process and why is it so important to debrief as well?
Sure.
Yeah.
I think the most important thing to realize is that trauma is not a wound that you can see on your body.
Okay.
Trauma is something that happens inside. And when a person goes through a physical trauma incident where maybe you were in an accident and you hurt your arm and your arm's broken, you can see your arm's broken and you know that you need care. But when we go through emotional traumas, we seldomly realize that we need to debrief. We need to de-traumatize, because those two things are two different things. Mm. And so in order to understand the process, I like to compare it to being physically wounded. Mm. When you're physically wounded, you go to the hospital, you go to the emergency ward, they bandage you, they disinfect you, they go through the wound to see the depth of the wound, and then they take certain precautions to heal you. And so emotional debriefing and de-traumatization is similar. healer in the sense of that you need to heal in your emotions. Even though you can't see that there is a scar on the inside, you need to heal from the inside emotions. And so debriefing is basically the process that's going to be sort of like an evaluation,
mm-hmm.
where you sit down and a counselor would sit with you probably and ask you questions. How did this happen? When did it happen? How did it make you feel? So it's sort of like debriefing is the initial process. Let's evaluate what just happened. Let's see how deep the wound is. And then we come up with a plan to de-traumatize you. To say, okay, now that we can see and assess how deep this wound is for you, because for me, it might sound silly, like a rat or a
spider.
A spider that you stepped on or something.
Yeah.
But for you, it might be very traumatic. And so I, as the counselor, need to debrief you and find out where exactly does the trauma lie for you? How deep is it? And what do we need to do in order to heal you?
So basically we sit down and then you'd have me talk about my experience several times over and over and over again.
So right. That's the de-traumatization. So yeah. there's two processes. Debriefing yeah. is something just happened to you. And so a lot of people never debrief.
Yeah.
So something traumatic just happened to me. And instead of going and speaking to somebody immediately about it, I keep it for myself. I archive it. I bottle it up. And so very few people debrief. Most people de-traumatize. So you'll go to a counselor and the counselor will sit down with you. We'll have a short debriefing to say, tell me your short story of your trauma. And then they'll schedule a de-traumatization. Now, what a de-traumatization is basically whenever a person experiences trauma that you don't deal with, you sit with a kind of intensity inside of you, almost a fear inside of you, a feeling of overwhelmedness. Yeah. You kind of carry the past with you.
Yeah.
So let's say the traumatic incident happened when you were a kid, you know, maybe you were molested, maybe your parents neglected you, because this is also something that people don't realize is that trauma doesn't just happen because of something that happens to you. You can be traumatized by not receiving the care that you're supposed to get.
Negligence.
Yes. And so basically de-traumatization is to sit down and to say that overwhelmed feeling that I'm still carrying inside of me from the past, that fear, that almost I call it a charge. That anxiety.
I like the word charge, yeah.
Is this, I don't feel quite right, you know. De-traumatization is basically to remove that charge. And the way that we do this, the way I do it, I'm not sure how all counselors do it, is to sit with you and you share your story with me.
Countless times over and over. I did that with Nandi as well, by the way.
Yes, so the theory behind it is that this charge inside of you is caused by adrenaline that is released within your body. We call it the fight or flight response.
Yeah,
so,
psychology. I remember that.
Yes.
Yeah.
So your body is created so wonderfully by God that God put inside of you something which is called the fight or flight response. Mm. And when you are in a dangerous situation, a traumatic situation, your body releases cortisol, your body releases adrenaline. Good hormones in a scary situation because it's going to get you out of there. Mm. But with most people, they don't work that cortisol and adrenaline out of their body. So they constantly feel this charge, this anxiety inside of them. And when you share your story over and over again, the body naturally works these chemicals out. In other words, that charge that you have inside of those chemical buildup that you have in your body, you tell the story, it's going to be overwhelming. You're going to cry. You're going to feel sad. You're going to feel maybe even scared again.
Yeah.
But if you keep telling the story over and over again in one session, eventually that anxiety releases. And you feel that relief from the distress that you've been feeling for many, many years.
I'm actually thinking of a little story you told me. If you mind sharing that with the viewers as well. You likened it to a story of the spring. Do you mind sharing that again, please? I really like that story.
Not a problem. I read it was actually not the whole book that I read. I read an intro in a book where this guy was explaining how trauma works.
Yeah.
And he was saying that in nature, when you look at animals, so for example, a springbok.
Yes.
When you watch National Geographic and you see a springbok busy grazing, eating some grass, a lot of times what happens is that the springbok knows that there are lions out there that might eat it, but it's not anxious about it.
Mm.
It knows that there's danger. It is alert, but it's not, you know, nervously alert. It's just aware of its surroundings. Now, what happens is if a lion comes and tries to hunt the springbok and kill the springbok, and it bites the springbok on the bum. The springbok, let's say he doesn't grab it, but he just bites it and the springbok gets away. The body of the springbok immediately releases adrenaline, cortisol, all those stress hormones in order to put it into fight or flight so the springbok can get out of the danger. And that's what happens in our bodies with trauma as well. So now what happens in nature is that the springbok will run from the lion and it will run. And it won't run like 30 meters and then stop. It will run and run and run and run. And then it will slowly start slowing down, slowing down, and then eventually it will stop. And when it stops, an interesting phenomenon happens. When the springbok stops, it doesn't stand there
shaking
and anxious and nervous.
Yeah.
It's actually calm. And this guy sort of investigated this in terms of trauma. And he was wondering, why does the springbok not have this nervousness, this hypervigilance, as we call it in psychology, of where's this lion? Yes, it's still alert, but it's calmly alert.
Yes.
And he says that he believes that the reason for this is because of the running process of the springbok running fast, trying to get away, that exercise of going and going and going and not stopping until all of those hormones are worked out of the springbok's body basically allows those chemicals to go out of the body. So when you detraumatize and you tell the story over and over again, it's a metaphorical type of running where we're going to run and tell the story and tell the story and tell the story until you eventually so tired that you stop. But then those chemicals will have been majorly worked out of your body.
That makes sense. So you can detraumatize with a medical practitioner like yourself, or myself as a life coach, or yourself, right? You can actually sit by yourself and create a time slot where you can detraumatize and go through your incident that you've gone through.
If you have the willpower to do so, what I have found most people say is that it feels weird to detraumatize on your own, but you can.
Yeah.
And then the willpower, especially if the story is very traumatic
and hurts a lot,
it's very difficult to speak out loud in your own room or write about it. Or, you know, maybe some people would like to record an audio talking about their trauma. It's difficult to do that because when you get to a difficult point, it's very easy to say, this is hurting me, I'm stopping, right? Yeah,
so
I'm not running anymore.
You need to have someone there helping, holding your hand, like, figuratively. Got it. So the last thing I want to speak about is that, sorry, I did sort of like derail a bit.
That's okay.
But the debriefing thing, which I also want to stress, which you've taught me about, which Nandi has told me, which you recommend is doing in the evening, if I'm correct. So as you wrap your day at the end of the night, you debrief. And would you like to please tell us what that is?
Sure. Yeah. So I have a belief that we build up a lot of trauma inside of our bodies without even realizing it. Daily traumas. It might not be big traumas. It might be small traumas. And so I believe that at the end of the day, we should detraumatize in the sense of reviewing your day, going over your day, and not in your mind thinking about it.
Saying
but it has to be either speaking it out loud
or writing
about it.
Okay.
Because in psychology, they teach that speaking and saying it out loud is disassociation. In other words, you're stepping away
from the trauma. Yeah.
Where when you think, you're associating. In other words, you're taking that trauma on you. So it's not good to just sit and think about it. But yes, at the end of each day, I believe you should review each day so that those traumas of that day doesn't get added into
the following day, the cup that you already have, actually.
Yes, you already have so many traumas that you haven't dealt with. Don't add today's traumas in as well. Debrief at the end of the day.
There's something I want to say that Pastor Nandi told me as well during our session. I like this a lot because I'm in media, right? She mentioned it in a way, well, those are my words, but how I also interpreted is changing your lens. So debriefing is another way of your brain looking at your day from another angle. Because as a current year right now, me and her are speaking, I'm interviewing her. This is present day time, right? But in the evening later on, when I re-look at our interview, my brain's looking at it from another angle, going that, oh, maybe I missed that, or maybe I missed that. So a lot of the times when you're going through something, you have emotions that you feel. But then 5 hours later, your emotions will feel differently about that incident, especially if it's a negative incident. So I found that to be very helpful. I personally do debrief every single night before I sleep. And I found that when I do that, I realize that, hey, actually, maybe I overthought that person's behavior. Maybe I actually was wrong. Then I go back and I try to apologize to those who I think I've wronged. So I will speak for this and saying that debriefing and detraumatizing does help a lot. It's almost like mental hygiene, cleaning the mind out. You know, getting rid of the clutter and the dust and starting your day anew. You never live in your house and have dirt pile up. So why do you allow dirt to pile up in your mind? That's how I see it.
I like that analogy.
I made it up right now. Okay. Okay, cool. So we've nailed that one. The next question. Okay, is with regards to anxiety. Okay, so something you did during one of our sessions, I really liked it. I've started to apply it to my life. And some people don't like it, but whatever. I'm not saying Nandi said I must do this, but anyway, she likened it to two things. I think let's start with the, I wrote down cage your dragons, but maybe you want to start with the first thing first, which is expect dragons.
Yes.
Yeah. So can you first start with the expecting dragons? Explain what that means. And then when you're done with that, can you explain caging your dragons and why it's so important? So, yeah.
So I came across this saying which they took out of ancient parables and things like that, where they say, prepare for dragons.
Yeah.
And I was like, what? Prepare for dragons? And I like this saying because they were basically saying, you know, like in the ancient times, if you believe in mystical tales and dragons and things like that, they didn't know when the dragons were going to invade their kingdoms. They didn't know when the next dragon was going to come and burn their barns or eat their animals. Or and so they used this saying to say, dragons come at any time. Mm-hmm. So you got to be prepared that you can't schedule your day in such a way that it is so full that if a dragon comes, your whole day falls apart. Mm-hmm. And dragons is basically a metaphor for unexpected occurrences.
Life.
Yes. Yeah. Stuff that just happens. and it could be something terrible. It could be something normal. But make sort of like slots in your day so that if things don't work out the way that it was, that if a dragon comes, you are prepared for it.
Yeah.
So that those unexpected emergencies. And then in terms of caging your dragons, even though things pop into your life, you know, certain things you have to deal with immediately. Mm. But a lot of times our dragons are mental.
Yes.
A lot of times our dragons are, I'm sitting and I'm busy doing my work and I have to focus on what's busy happening right now. And all of a sudden I remember that friend of mine that did that thing. And now there's a dragon in my mind. There's nothing happening around me, but there's a dragon in my mind. And I'm like, oh, this person is, I'm so angry at them. They're irritating me. And so sometimes we need to learn to cage, especially our mental dragons.
Yeah.
To say, dragon, I hear you here. But, and so I recommend taking your diary, sitting down, making a note and saying, dragon, I'm seeing you. You know, I need to deal with the traumatizing on that thing, which is now popped into my head tonight, not now. So you cage that dragon and you say, my friend that said that ugly word to me, that's now bothering me in my brain. I don't have the capacity to deal with it right now because I'm busy with an interview.
Yes, yes.
Let me cage it. And I set a time to deal with that dragon where I let the dragon out and I de-traumatize or debrief on that dragon, and I either do it on my own or with God, or I speak to a friend in order to deal with that, in order to debrief.
So I like that because I used to pride myself in multitasking, and it's actually a fallacy. There's no such thing. You know, and Nandi made me realize that, you know, the business of life gets overwhelming, you know, and in the long run, you find yourself juggling all these balls, and what happens to someone juggles balls, they fall, right? So now if you can learn to handle and deal with each little situation in your life, you get more done that way, as opposed to just saying, I'm going to try and juggle 8 things and be proud of it. It's nothing to be proud of that you are living a life that you can't balance or manage, overwhelms you, and you have nervous breakdowns, which would happen to me a lot. I would find myself sitting there and I go into deep depression because I'm like, oh, I'm not coping. You know, I'm not coping. But now I've realized that there's times where I'm like, and I'm going into the question that I actually didn't tell you properly. Anyway, I remember this as I was making notes. I like what Pastor Nandi said to me last time in our session. I think our last session, you mentioned the whole notion of how back then, years ago, like donkey years ago, eons ago, many moons ago, people didn't have phones. They had to send messages via pigeons and all that. And you'd meet them at the country fair months later. That's how life was. But now, because people literally live in our pockets, like our pockets right now. So you mentioned notion of when you go to bed, you ask me, Tabby, would you like to have 9 people in your bed? I was like, no, why? Then you mentioned the whole idea of WhatsApp. Can we get into that quickly and how you explained that to me as well, which I think also ties into Caging Your Dragons as well, because WhatsApp social media is another way of how we literally have a lot of dragons in one place, and then we try to multitask and still be a mom and still be a wife and still do this and do that, but then you have everyone else that's literally in your pocket. So can you go more into that as well? I really like that explanation. Yeah,
not a problem. So in terms of social media and specifically WhatsApp, what I have found is that even before WhatsApp, even after pigeons, you know, we just had text message. And if somebody sent you a text message, you could reply when you wanted to. People didn't see the green or the blue tick or oh, you are online, but you're busy ignoring me. And so media has become kind of instant in the sense of that there's this instant demand that you must be available now.
Yes.
And specifically with phones, you know, and what I mentioned to Tabby was like, you know, at night, what time at night do you sit on your WhatsApp and you're busy scrolling through WhatsApp, speaking to many people, speaking to clients, speaking to work, speaking to your boss, speaking to friends, speaking to family? I'm like, technically by texting them in bed on your phone, you have brought those people into your bed. And that's not appropriate.
Mm-mm.
If you physically had to do that in order to sort of like speak to somebody, if you didn't have phones and you were like, I need to speak to my boss now and it's 9 o'clock at night, you would have to have called them into your bedroom and you would never have done
that.
But yet we're doing it through our phones.
Yes.
We're inviting people not just into our beds, but into our private spaces. So when I'm supposed to be sitting at the table having supper with my family, I'm on my
texting.
Phone. So I'm basically inviting somebody into my family time. When I'm busy with worship, I'm busy quickly answering the WhatsApp. When I'm in church, I'm quickly texting somebody. And so these boundaries have become very blurred. And I kind of feel like in the olden days, you know, things were much simpler.
Yeah.
It was much more easy to cage those dragons, to say, you know, a bedroom is for sleeping. It's for a bed. It's not a place where there's a TV or a cell phone or a laptop. A study is where I study and do my work. A dining room is where I dine with my family and I sit down and I have a nice meal. And so we have allowed our life's dragons to infiltrate every room
they
of
go
our house. Every area of our life.
Uncaged.
Yes, they're completely
around,
like
running about.
They're like crazy little monsters.
Breathing fire.
And we think we can manage this. And then at the end of the day, we feel overwhelmed, we feel anxious, and you're like, why? Why am I feeling? Because life is not simple anymore.
No, it isn't.
Yeah.
I think it's because of us. Okay, well, thanks, Pastor Nandi. I appreciate this so much. Don't think anything else. I have anything else to ask regarding this, because we will be chatting to you in the next few days regarding our next episode. So usually I do a prayer at the end of each episode, but because I have the honor of having you here, I would like you to please close in prayer regarding the specific discussion we had. And please, what you also mentioned, what I normally do is pray for the people that are watching this and who have gone through this. The main mission behind the safe space with Tabby M is for healing. It's not for the peanut gallery. I don't care about them. It's about those who really are seeking help, who need help, who want change, who want a connection with God, and who want to heal holistically and really want to see a difference in their life. So the prayers are for them. So please.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this opportunity we've had to do this podcast and just to be able to share a little bit about what trauma is and how it affects a person, and that there is ways and means in order to de-traumatize, in order to heal from these things. Lord, we've just dropped a little piece in the bucket. There's so much more, but I pray that the listeners, those who will be tuning in, Lord, that those who are in need of healing, who have been through traumatic incidences, whether it's in the past or whether it's current, Lord, that you will give them hope, that you will encourage them to know that there is help and that they will reach out to find help and to be able to heal, Lord, with you along their side. Lord, bless Tabby with this program that she is running. Lord, may you help her to touch many lives and to help many of her listeners to heal through these episodes. Be with us now, Lord, is my prayer in your name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, that's a wrap, guys. Thank you so much. Lots of love. God bless. Mwah.
If you shine.